campaign launch at that particular point in time. As mentioned off the top of the program, we're joined now by the Home Affairs Minister, Jason Clare. Welcome to the program.
Thanks, mate.
And joining me on the panel, we're joined by both from The Australian, Troy Bramston, senior columnist, and economics correspondent, Adam Crichton. Welcome to the program, gentlemen. Yeah. Jason Clare, can I just ask you about Kitchengate? We won't dwell on this, but even if you accept the statement that was put out by the Prime Minister's office that this was pre-arranged and that he couldn't have had his briefings in Canberra any earlier than he did, so he was able to do his four-hour taping of that particular program, it's just a bad political move, isn't it, to announce that you've got urgent briefings that you've got to get to Canberra for before then doing a four-hour recording?
Well, the advice I've got is the story is wrong, that the people and the papers necessary to do that briefing couldn't be organised until that evening. If they could have been arranged earlier, then the interview would have been cancelled or postponed and the Prime Minister would have went to Canberra earlier.
But I'm giving the Prime Minister the benefit of the doubt on that and I'm accepting that release and that understanding. I'm simply making the point that even allowing for that, that he did have this window of opportunity to do it, don't you think it's bad political manoeuvring, I guess, to announce that you are going to be urgently heading to Canberra before then turning around and spending a few hours doing a kitchen
show? Commentators analyse all the minutiae of an election campaign. They're busy. You've got to do lots of things. A pre-arranged interview that would have been cancelled if this briefing could have occurred earlier. It couldn't occur until later in the night when the papers and the people were available to brief the Prime Minister and the Foreign Minister. And as soon as they were available, the briefing occurred. We're on the UN Security Council. It's appropriate that the Prime Minister receive this briefing. You'd expect the same sort of briefing is happening around the world. The French President, UK Prime Minister, Barack Obama. If the allegations of what has occurred in Syria are correct, then there are serious decisions that need to be made by the Security Council.
OK, can I ask you about the boats policy that was released on Friday by the coalition, this sort of boats buyback idea out of Indonesia? It actually sounds sillier to me than the cash for clunkers concept.
Well, it's a stupid policy. Tony Burke made the point on Friday. There's 750,000 boats out there in Indonesia. The idea that the opposition are putting up is that you can stop the boats by buying those boats one at a time. Just think about how this would work in practice. You try and stop a boat by buying one boat, a people smuggler will just buy another boat. It's like trying to stop somebody from buying a car by going down to Auto Alley on Parramatta Road and buying one car. It's just a silly, silly idea.
Do we have any numbers behind this in terms of the price point at which they're expecting to purchase them, the number that they would seek to purchase them, and what they would do with them once they do buy them?
Yeah, we don't have any of that. But what they would do, in effect, is give money to somebody to buy their boat off them. They'd presumably use that money to buy another boat. That'd be sold to a people smuggler. It would come out to Christmas Island, and then we'd have to burn the boat that we effectively bought. So it's just a stupid idea. If you want to stop people getting onto boats and drowning, then you've got to remove the incentive for the person seeking asylum to get on the boat, rather than remove the incentive to sell a boat to a people smuggler. And that's what the agreement with PNG is all about.
Minister, we're now at the end of the third week of the election campaign. 3 weeks ago, the Labor Party was at 50-50 in most of the major polls. It's headed south since then. Labor seems to be well behind and is not making up any ground. There's new polls out yesterday. The news poll suggested Kevin Rudd could lose his own seat. The government would effectively be decapitated. So what is happening to the Labor campaign? Why hasn't any of the key messages cut through with voters? And why is Labor so far behind with only 2 weeks to go?
Troy, it's tough. There's a battle going on out there. I think Tony Abbott's right when he says that things are tighter than the polls show at the moment. I'll let others commentate on where they think the two parties are, but I think it is right to say we're behind. I think the most important day in the election campaign hasn't happened yet. Judgment Day will be when the opposition release their costings, which we now think is next week, Thursday or Friday. That could be the birthday cake moment for the opposition leader, when he has to reveal where the cuts come from, the cuts to health, the cuts to education, the cuts to things like jobs. And when people find out just how brutal the cuts will be under Tony Abbott, people will think again. There's a lot of people out there that don't like the idea of Tony Abbott as Prime Minister, and okay, I suspect there'll be a lot of pens quivering in voting booths on election day at that prospect.
Well, that's certainly where Labor's wanted to pivot the campaign, but what about Kevin Rudd as Prime Minister? What about a Labor government? What is the key message that I don't think many voters have latched onto yet as the reason to re-elect Labor for a third term?
Well, it's about the things that we've done and the things that we will do if we're elected. You know, under Kevin Rudd, we stopped Australia going into recession and saved hundreds of thousands of jobs. Under Kevin Rudd and Julia Gillard, helped to build and establish disability care, rebuild our skills, build the NBN. We are builders. That's what the Labor Party does. And the argument that we make to the Australian people is that if we're re-elected, the NBN will be built and go all the way to your home. If Tony Abbott becomes Prime Minister, it'll stop down the road. If we're re-elected, everyone will have their superannuation increased. If Tony Abbott becomes Prime Minister, that won't happen. And if we're re-elected, then there'll be millions more going to our local schools. If Tony Abbott becomes Prime Minister, there'll be millions less going to our schools, and that's what's at stake at this election.
But, Minister, can I just ask you, I mean, you mentioned as one of the reasons for re-election that Kevin Rudd as Prime Minister helped steer us through the global financial crisis. That wasn't even reason for you as a party to retain him till the end of his first term to face the people. Why would it be a reason after two full terms to re-elect Labor and him as Prime Minister for a third?
Well, I represent the people of Western Sydney, 150,000 people who kept their jobs because of what this government did, working together, Wayne Swan, Julia Gillard and Kevin Rudd. I remember the 90s when my dad lost his job during a recession. Unemployment got up to 16%. Now, that didn't happen here like it happened around the world because of the decisions that this government took. And that's why I say we are the builders, we're the protectors of jobs. The Coalition have a different approach on this. They would have let the economy slide into recession and we would have seen a repeat of the 90s where a whole generation of people would have lost their jobs and the crime and the chaos that comes with that.
Minister, can I just ask briefly on the issue of cost of living? Both of the major political parties have been, I guess, in a way, attempting to convince the electorate that there are rising cost of living pressures. And obviously, you're from Western Sydney, so you've probably been doing this as well. With an inflation rate of only 2.2 or 2.3%, I mean, is this argument continuing to bite? And if it is biting, I mean, isn't it somewhat disingenuous to be making it when the rate of inflation is so low?
Well, cost of living is a big issue right across the country. I think it's even bigger in Western Sydney because the average income is lower than other parts of Sydney, but the price of housing is higher or as high as other parts of Sydney, and so there's less disposable income. And so it's an issue that I hear about all the time. The changes in interest rates have been good news for people that I represent. 5 years ago, when I became a Member of Parliament, 60 families a day were having their homes repossessed in Bankstown, in my electorate, every month. Now that's down to one or two.
But in terms of what the government's actually doing, though, because, I mean, the interest rates are obviously controlled by the Reserve Bank, right, not the federal government. So you are lifting the superannuation guarantee, say, which is going to reduce people's take-home pay. That's obviously not helping their cost of living, right?
Well, that sets people up for the future. I think we had this argument 20 years ago. The Liberals said superannuation was a bad idea. I think we've won that debate, like we've won the debate on Medicare and we've won the debate on disability care. But in terms of cost of living, simple things like the school kids bonus that give parents $800 if they've got a young person at high school make all the difference. Over the course of their time at school, two kids, it means parents get $15,000. Now, that's a big difference for any family in Western Sydney or Western Australia or anywhere else in the country, and that's what will go under Tony Abbott.
Can I ask you a question about the relationship between Chris Bowen and Wayne Swan? There's a report in today's Sunday Telegraph, there was reporting by Troy Bramston during the week in The Australian on the same issue, that the two haven't spoken. Chris Bowen has admitted that he hasn't since the coup against Julia Gillard, rather, it's hard to keep up with who, back in June, he and Wayne Swan have not had any sort of handover, any sort of discussion. A campaign that's all about economic management, a treasurer that was voted greatest treasurer in the world, according to Money Magazine in Europe, has not even had a handover conversation with the new Labor treasurer from the same party. Doesn't that strike you as odd?
Oh, well, they took different views on the leadership, so that's not unexpected. Chris is a friend of mine.
Can't they put that to one side and be professional about their economic handover?
Chris is a friend of mine. I think he's doing a terrific job as treasurer. If you saw Q&A last week, you'd know that he wiped the floor with Joe Hockey. This is not just a battle between Kevin Rudd and Tony Abbott. It's who do you want to be responsible for managing the Australian economy, Chris Bowen or Joe Hockey? That's an easy decision.
But you're not answering the question. I mean, are you at least a little surprised or disappointed that there wouldn't have been some sort of professional handover on the economy despite disagreements on leadership?
I think I did, Peter. In the story, you'll see that Chris says he's got enormous respect for Wayne, that he thought that he did a very good job as Treasurer, and I've made the case for why I think he did as well. He stopped people in the areas that I represent from losing their jobs, and that's what Labor government's first and foremost responsibility is.
But Chris Bowen didn't decide to pick his brain and get some ideas going forward, taking over such an important portfolio.
That's a question to ask Chris rather than me. They took different views on the leadership of the party.
Now, Minister, you represent Western Sydney, as you've said. There's a whole bunch of ministers and parliamentary secretaries in Western Sydney holding those Labor seats. One of the arguments put when Julia Gillard was Prime Minister by them was that she was tanking the Labor vote and that Kevin Rudd would turbocharge it. What do you think on the ground now? Has Kevin Rudd lifted Labor's vote in Western Sydney, or, as the polls suggest, are you still neck and neck in terms of some of those seats maybe falling to the coalition?
Yeah, I made the decision to support Kevin because I feared a wipeout that was going to happen across the country, which wasn't good for the Labor Party and not good for Australia. And I do see that when I talk to people in my electorate, that there's strong support for Kevin Rudd. I've told the story before about a person who said to me, "I'm so glad you brought Kevin back. Now I don't have to vote for Tony Abbott." He's not loved, he's not liked, whereas Kevin Rudd is loved by many people.
So does that mean community. That Julia Gillard was really on the nose in Western Sydney?
Oh, I think I've made the point that Labor risked the prospect of not having representation from Sydney as the crow flies to Fremantle. That was at risk. I couldn't afford to let that happen. That's why I made the decision that it was important to change leaders in order to make sure Labor was competitive at this election, and I believe we are.
Yeah, but still it looks as if the Kevin Rudd factor has not lifted Labor's vote to the level it needs to be confident of holding some of those seats. Now, you're in one of the safest seats. That's probably still in the Labor column, but there's a bunch of others now, maybe half a dozen in Western Sydney, that are still at risk. So does that mean that Kevin Rudd has not turbocharged Labor's vote as you would have hoped?
Troy, I'll let commentators make that assessment. I'm not a commentator. I'm on the field. I'm involved in this battle, fighting to retain those seats, because I believe people like Chris and I, who come from Western Sydney, are the right people to represent the people of Western Sydney. We're born and raised there, got our first jobs there. We know the area, we love it. It's where our families and our friends are, and it's the people that we want to represent in Canberra.
I want to pivot onto your portfolio area, or one of your portfolio areas, the area of customs. Now, Operation Heritage, looking at corruption within customs, is something that you've done since you've been minister there. I want to talk a little bit about that, and also then I guess about guns and the role of customs with guns. We've got Barry O'Farrell coming up shortly, and he's talked about that. You and him are in disagreement on that issue. But starting with Operation Heritage, how systemic is corruption within customs, and how worried should Australians be about it?
Well, the first point I should make is that the majority of customs officers are good, honest, hard-working men and women, and no one was more disgusted with what we found than customs officers were. I had one customs officer ring my office after we announced the arrest of a customs officer and say he went to the same coffee shop every day in his uniform to get a cup of coffee before work, and he'd wear his uniform. And the day that I announced that we'd arrested a customs officer, he put a jacket over his uniform. That's how disgusted, how angry and upset he was. And when I was at the airport over Christmas, I had customs officers saying to me, "Go get them." That's what we've done. Using the template that Justice James Wood provided in the New South Wales Royal Commission: integrity testing, drug and alcohol testing, mandatory reporting, summary dismissal powers. And I've asked James Wood to sit on the Customs Reform Board to give us other recommendations that we're now implementing, such as limiting the time that people can spend in one particular job. You won't be working at the airport for your whole life. You'll move from one area of customs to another. You need to do that in order to change the culture of the organisation and prevent corruption from festering and having a repeat of what we've seen.
What's the opposition's reaction to this? Because if the polls are right, and if there is going to be a change of government in 2 weeks, despite your best efforts to stop that, is there bipartisan support for some of these changes that are still ongoing?
Yeah, when I released the blueprint to reform customs, the opposition supported that blueprint. I think that is a good thing. This is something that should be above politics. We need to implement all of these reforms. But the reforms to customs are bigger than just tackling corruption. We expect over the next 5 years to have a tripling in the amount of air cargo driven by people buying things off the internet, a massive increase in international passengers driven by the rise of China, lots more tourists coming to Australia. So we need to automate our borders. So instead of going through the border and getting your passport stamped, you can get your passport scanned and go. We need to use intelligence to target the right parcels and the right packages. You can't X-ray everything. And we need to create a new ethos and culture inside customs, and that involves establishing a training college.
And on that issue of you can't X-ray everything, the issue of gun importation is something that New South Wales Premier Barry O'Farrell really believes, that it's the federal government's lack of funding and lack of focus, in his view, about seizing guns through customs, which is leading to gun crime in parts of Sydney, particularly in your area of Western Sydney more broadly. How do you react to that?
Well, he would say that. Premiers do say those sorts of things. He's wrong. He's wrong. Importation, illegal importation of weapons is a small part of a much bigger problem. We've got 250,000 illegal guns on the streets of Australia in the hands of criminals. Most of those weapons are weapons that are stolen. They're legally imported, then they're stolen from legitimate owners and put on the street. We've seen a 265% increase in the theft of handguns last year, or their weapons on the street that weren't handed in after the Port Arthur massacre. We did a tracing analysis of 3,000 weapons seized from criminals in the last few years, and we're able to identify that less than 1% of them were illegal imports. So if we're going to seriously tackle this issue, then sure, you've got to do work on the borders, and I'm doing that work, but you've also got to be tough on penalties for possessing weapons illegally on the streets and give police more power to search criminals for guns. I've called for the Premier, and I've called for all Premiers to implement powers that allow for random searches of serious criminals for handguns, like the powers that exist in South Australia at the moment. They're called firearm prohibition orders, and they allow you to stop and search serious criminals, their cars, their houses, or wherever they are at any time for firearms. South Australia's implemented these laws and they're working. Barry O'Farrell should as well.
Minister, can I just ask, these measures all sound very impressive, but what impact are they having on the payroll and the cost of your department? I understand it's one of the fastest growing departments on both measures, and actually has been for quite some time. Is there any concern that the headcount and also the cost is growing too rapidly?
Well, you're right, they're big reforms. The blueprint involves the implementation of some reforms that will cost money and others which are just that don't require additional funds but change the way we do business. We're going to draw on money from within existing resources to implement some of those reforms, but I've also asked Customs to prepare a two-stage business case to put to government over the course of the next 6 months about additional funds that are required to implement the sorts of reforms that are identified in the blueprint.
What's the total headcount, sorry, of Customs? What is it roughly?
Oh, it's around about 5,000. Yeah.
Can I ask you about ASADA before we let you go? Now, there's been some criticism coming from various quarters that yourself and the sports minister came out too hard too early, given what has happened since with ASADA, with the investigation still being ongoing and there not being charges having laid yet. Do you reject that?
Well, go back and see what I said, Peter. I said we're talking here about multiple players, number of codes, number of clubs. All of that is correct. We know, everyone here at this table, everyone watching knows that we've got a problem with drugs in sport. People have been whispering about it for years and years, but not enough has been done about it. This is about getting something done. Let me give you one example. Last year, in the Queensland Rugby League competition at the grand final, ASADA made the decision to do four tests of people. All four came back positive for using a banned drug. So whether it's at an elite level or a sub-elite level, this is an issue which is serious. Some of the drugs that people have been using have been linked to the death of a marathon runner in London. So we're talking about some drugs that aren't approved for human use, drugs that have been linked to the death of people in a marathon in London. It's serious. We care about people's safety, and that's why this work's so important.
Is one of the problems in the AFL that they have this three strikes policy? So you can be caught with drugs, even if they're recreational drugs, once or twice before actually ultimately being suspended?
Look, that's a policy decision for the AFL. From my portfolio's perspective, the concern is that when you've got people that are using recreational drugs, it means invariably that they're dealing with criminals. And that creates the prospect of relationships forming between players and organised crime.
Some of these drugs that the sports people are using, they are actually legal drugs, though, aren't they? They aren't kind of illegal in the criminal law. And so to the extent that that's true, I mean, shouldn't the government just leave this entirely to the sporting codes themselves?
I think the drug you're talking about, which has been the subject of some discussion this week, the AOD drug, is a drug which hasn't been approved for human use anywhere in the world. It's a test drug, it's a research drug, an anti-obesity drug, and can only be used, if you look at the label on the drug, you can see it's a research drug. It can only be used if you're part of a test. So we're talking here, as I said before, about some drugs here that aren't approved for human use. In that case, that drug there is a drug that is banned by WADA and ASADA.
There's only 2 weeks to go in the campaign left, Minister. Do you give a commitment that you'll serve a full term if you're re-elected as member for Blaxland? And also, have you given any consideration... I asked the question because a lot of ministers after a period in government decide to pull the pin and walk away. We saw that when the last government fell over. And there's suggestions in Labor Party circles that a number of ministers, even if they're re-elected, may not serve a full term. So I want to ask you about that. But also, have you thought about future leadership ambitions for yourself, and do you rule in or rule out possibly being a candidate down the track?
Well, the answer to the first question is yes. The answer to the second question, I think, is no. There might have been a third question there. Troy, I honestly still pinch myself that I'm a Member of Parliament. It is a real privilege. As I said before, I get to represent the place where I grew up. And yes, if I get the opportunity to serve my community again, I certainly will do it for a full term. I've got no aspirations to be the leader of the Labor Party. My dream job one day would be to be the Minister for Education, because I know what that would mean for the community that I represent. Education is the game changer here. It's what gives boys from Cabramatta the opportunity to do jobs like this.
But can I ask about this issue? If you say you have no ambitions to be leader of the Labor Party, I'm not asking about tomorrow or even next year or even the next 3 years of the term necessarily, but you must harbour some ambition to be Labor leader. You're often touted as a future Labor leader.
Well, they might be touted, but I have no desire to do that job at all. What I said, I mean.
Why not?
For me, I feel like I am part of the team, not the leader of the team. And the opportunity to do a job like education, I think, would be a job that could change the lives of a generation.
So you'd like, maybe this is an early audition for the education role, either in opposition or in government after the next election?
I think it's no secret. I've told all of my colleagues that this is a portfolio one day I would love to have.
OK. Jason Clare, we're going to take a commercial break. We appreciate your company on Australian Agenda. Thanks very much for joining us.
Thanks, Peter.
Stay with us. When we come back, we'll be joined by the New South Wales Premier...